Welcome to study session 7, Anatomy of the Female External Genitalia and Antenatal Booking. Introduction. As a midwife, there is a need to learn about the female genitalia, antenatal care, and booking. The female external genitalia are the breasts and the structures of the pelvic bone. They are organs that play important roles in pregnancy. In this session, you will learn about the breast, how to describe both the external and internal structures of the female breast. You will also be learning about the pelvis, its contents, and how the contents are arranged. This study session will be concluded by learning about the screening test carried out during booking and/or subsequent antenatal care visits. Learning outcomes. When you have studied this session, you should be able to 1. Discuss the anatomy of the female breast. Discuss the anatomy of the female pelvis. Explain the antenatal care and booking. Describe the midwife's history. Anatomy of the female breast. The breasts are two secreting glands in form of hemispherical swellings at the anterior chest wall, lying over pectoralis major muscle, extending to serratus anterior, an external oblique muscle. The female breast is situated between the second and sixth ribs and middle margin of sternum and mid-axilla. Description of the female breast. You should hold the breast model in anatomical position on one hand and hold the pointer, which can be a ruler or a pen, on the other hand. Use the pointer to point on the external structure of the breast and describe as follows. The nipple. This is a flat-topped erectile protuberance at the center of the breast. It is 6 mm in length, situated at the level of the fourth intercostal space, perforated by 18 to 20 nipple ducts. Areola. This is a circular pigmented area, pink or black at the base of the nipple. It measures 2.5 cm in diameter. Sebaceous glands. These are 18 small glands within the areola. They become Montgomery tubercles. They produce oily substance, sebum, which act as lubricants during pregnancy and throughout breastfeeding. Internal or microscopic structure of the female breast. You should now open the model and identify ducts and lobes with your pointer as follows. Glandular tissue. This is the main substance of the breast, partitioned by fibrous band into lobes which are 18 to 20 in number. Each lobe is a complete unit and does not communicate with another. Lobes are subdivided into lobules. Lobules. These are made up of milk excreting units, which are alveolar and ducts. Each alveolus consists of milk-forming cells called acini cells, surrounded by myoepithelial cells, which contract and propels the milk out. Lactiferous ducts. The lactiferous ducts carry milk from the alveolar, unite to form larger ducts. One larger duct leaves each lobe and widens to form a lactiferous sinus or ampulla for storage of milk. A lactiferous tubule from each sinus emerges on the surface of the nipple. Blood supply, venous drainage, lymph drainage, and functions of breast. The blood supply to the breast is through the internal and external mammary arteries, as well as upper intercostal arteries. The veins form a circular network around nipple and drain to the internal mammary and axillary veins. Lymph drains into the axillary glands in both axillae, glands in the anterior mediastinum, and glands in the portal fissure of the liver. The functions of the breast include for breastfeeding and for cosmetic purposes. Anatomy of the female pelvis. The pelvis is gutter-shaped. Its outlet is filled with the pelvic floor muscle. It is pierced through by the urethra, the vagina, and the anus. It is arranged in layers as follows from within. Peritoneum, broad ligament. Pelvic fascia, cervical ligament. Deep pelvic muscle layer, levator ani. superficial pelvic muscle layer, perineal muscles, fat, skin. Muscles of the superficial layer, perineal muscles. Now, hold the model of the pelvic floor muscles correctly in anatomical position and use your pointer, which can either be a ruler or a pen, to identify the superficial pelvic muscles as follows. The superficial layer muscles, also known as the perineal muscles, are 5 in number. They are the external and sphincter. This encircles the anus and is attached behind to the coccyx by a few fibers. Transverse perineal muscle. It passes from the ischial tuberosity to the center of the perineum. Bulbo cave muscles muscle. It passes from the perineum forwards around to the corpora cavernosa of the clitoris. Ischial cavernosus muscle. It passes from the ischial tuberosity along the pubic arc to the corpora cavernosa. Membranous sphincter of the urethra. It is composed of muscle fibers passing above and below the urethra and attached to the pubic bones. Note that these perineal muscles are very important to midwives because they are liable to injuries during childbirth. Antenatal booking and antenatal care. Booking can be referred to as the registration of a pregnant woman during her first visit to the hospital or at her first contact with the midwife. It is very important for a pregnant woman to register early enough in the hospital. As soon as she missed her menstruation for 2 consecutive months and pregnancy is confirmed through pregnancy test. Antenatal care can be described as a series of interventions a midwife offers to a pregnant woman throughout the pregnancy period. It is equally very important to attend antenatal clinic regularly. Therefore, you as a midwife must know that since the pregnant woman will be visiting the hospital for the first time for booking, the reception she receives at this interview is likely to color the rest of her experience. You should remember, first impression lasts longer. In order for the clients to have good impression about you as a midwife, you must possess the following qualities. You must be friendly and approachable. You must have good listening skills, showing interest in the woman as a person. You must be able to analyze information. You must respect your client's privacy. Importance and aims of antenatal care visits. The importance and aims of antenatal care are as follows. To enable you as a midwife to take relevant history that will allow you to identify possible problems early and solve them. To assist you in identifying any risk factor and take appropriate action. To guide you in monitoring the growth of the fetus as well as the health of the mother. To be able to provide necessary and appropriate health information to your clients. Components of antenatal care. The components of ANC are as follows. Midwife's history, screening procedures, physical examination, health talk. Midwife's history. You as a midwife would take the midwife's history using the antepartum risk assessment or intervention form. Antepartum risk assessment and intervention form helps you as a midwife to monitor the woman during the antenatal period. This can be achieved by keeping good record of information about the client as well as good history taking. The history to be taken includes social history. This includes client's name, age, habits like smoking or alcohol, educational level. You should ask questions like, is the partner supportive? If the partner is not supportive, the client is more likely to have problems getting good diet. Therefore, she might be at risk of anemia. Is the mother employed? If the mother is unemployed, she might be financially handicapped to settle hospital bills. Therefore, she might plan not to deliver in the hospital. Medical and surgical history. It is important for you to have a complete medical and surgical history. If she should have a history of sickle cell disease, diabetes, heart disease, or epilepsy, she needs to see a doctor during this pregnancy. Note that women with any of these conditions can develop complications and die. Therefore, you as a midwife should work closely with the doctor so as to agree on her treatment plan. If she had previous surgery, it is important to determine if it might cause complications during this pregnancy. Family history. You should take history of some genetic conditions like hypertension and diabetes mellitus. Also, you should take family history of multiple pregnancies. Previous obstetrical history. In this section, you ask a lot of questions about her previous pregnancies. If she has had many pregnancies, more than 5, closely spaced pregnancies, less than 2 years, or previous hemorrhages, she will have risk of having anemia during this pregnancy. She is also at higher risk of postpartum hemorrhage with the present pregnancy. Therefore, it is important for you as midwife to monitor her closely. Also, if your client has a history of hypertension or if she is pregnant for the first time, she is more likely to develop pregnancy-induced hypertension. Therefore, you need to monitor her closely. Menstrual history. You need to take history of her last menstrual period, LMP, so as to be able to calculate her expected date of delivery, EDD. Also, if she has a history of heavy or frequent periods, watch her closely for anemia. If her periods are not regular, it will be important to try to calculate her EDD using size of the uterus combined with best history you can get. How to calculate the expected date of delivery? There are many ways of calculating the EDD, but the considered simplest way will be discussed here. To calculate the EDD, take the following steps. Step 1. Add 7 to the day. If result is more than 30, minus 30 and carry it over as a month. Step 2. Add 9 to the month. If result is greater than 12, minus 12 and carry it over as a year. Example 1. Calculate the EDD for LMP of 4th February 2013. Add 7 to the day and 9 to the month. That would be 11th November 2013. Calculate the EDD for LMP of 25th April 2013. Add 7 to the day and 9 to the month. And that would be 2nd February 2014. Note, you need to inform your client that the exact date of delivery can be any day within 2 weeks plus or minus the EDD. Hence, the need for her to know signs of labor so as to report promptly at the hospital whenever she notices any sign of labor. Summary of Study Session 7. In Study Session 7, you have learned that 1. Female breast lies over muscle of the anterior chest wall and located between the 2nd and the 6th ribs. The nipple, the areola, and the sebaceous glands are the external structures of the female breast. 3. When you open the breast model, you can identify the internal or the microscopic structures of the breast. 4. Major functions of the female breast are for breastfeeding and for cosmetic purposes. 5. The outlet of the pelvis is filled with pelvic muscle floors. 6. Layers of the pelvic floor are arranged orderly, specifically its arrangement from within. 7. There are 5 muscles of the superficial layer of the pelvic floor. 8. Deep pelvic muscles are also known as the levatorani. 8. A midwife must possess some qualities to be able to get adequate and appropriate history from her client. 10. Booking and regular antenatal care visits is important for safe delivery. 11. There are 4 major components of antenatal care visit. 12. You can take adequate midwife's history using antepartum risk assessment and intervention form. End of study session 7. Thanks for listening.